Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing bone types. Specifically, we will talk through the five main types of bones and the characteristics and a few examples of each type. These characteristics will sometimes help in understanding the individual function of these bones. All right, I always like to start with long bones because I think they are easy to conceptualize. Long bones will have a greater length than width, but always with a slight curve, particularly in terms of the body of the long bones, to help absorb stress from body weight and for just general strength. These bones are mostly compact bone in the body region, so in this region here will be mostly compact bone, and then the ends of the bone will be made up of mostly spongy bone. The humerus, which you see here, which is the longest bone of the upper limb, is an example of a long bone, as are the larger femurs, as well as the forearms, radius and ulna, and the leg bones, the tibia and fibula. But also some smaller bones in the hand and feet, like metacarpals, metatarsals, and phalanges, which, while smaller, they're still longer than they are wide, so officially long bones. And you can even see some of those over here. In this region, short bones are more cube-like with a nearly equal length, width, and even depth. So, such as what you can see here with these carpal bones. So, we were talking about how some of these are more long bones over here, but your carpal bones are really excellent examples of short bones. So carpal bones, many of the tarsal bones that are associated with the ankle region are also short bones. These are almost completely composed of spongy bone, except for a thin outer layer of compact bone. Flat bones are pretty descriptive in terms of their name. They're going to be composed of two parallel but slightly curved plates or tables. These are going to be made up of compact bone, and then you will have spongy bone in the middle region right there. The sternum or the breastbone is a good example of a flat bone, but many of the cranial bones as well as even the ribs are considered flat bones. Next, we have the sesamoid bones, which are actually one of my personal all-time favorite types of bones. And these are super neat because they form and develop within certain tendons. So remember, tendons are going to connect muscle to bone. So you're going to have bone forming within tendons, particularly in areas where there's considerable stress and or friction or compression. These bones may not be completely ossified even into adulthood, and the number of sesamoid bones in the body can vary from person to person. So, the next time someone says that there are 206 individual bones in an adult skeleton, you can smartly add, well, if you aren't considering the possibility of different sesamoid bones, and you will be ever so popular at your next dinner party. There are two main types of sesamoid bones. There is the patella, which you can see here, or your kneecap, as well as the pisiform bones in the wrist region, which are one of your carpal bones. And there are other common but typically unnamed sesamoid bones in the big toe or your first toe and your thumb region. These are going to be formed in tendons there. The fifth category of bone is for all the other bones that just don't fit into one of the other four categories, and these are the irregular bones. These have very complex shapes, as you can see here in the vertebrae, which are an excellent example of irregular bones. Many of the facial bones of the skull, the calcaneus or the heel bone, these are all examples of irregular bones. All right. So those are the five types of bone. When we get to discussing each bone in subsequent sessions, I want you to think, what type of bone is this? And why don't we get started on that right now? Okay, so this arrow is pointing at the left coxal bone. We often refer to this as the hip bone. What type of bone is this? Just look at it. What do you think it is? Is it flat, irregular, long, sesamoid, or short? So take a minute and pause the video if you need to and kind of think through it. But when you're ready, let's talk through it together, because this one's kind of tricky. Because really, when you're looking at this particular portion of the coxal bone, it is relatively flat, but the inferior and posterior portions, which I know you can't see the posterior portion here, they don't fit within the flat category. So we're not going to go with flat. Flat is not going to be the correct answer. The left coxal bone or the right coxal bone, either one, are certainly not long or short bones. And it's not a sesamoid bone either. First off, I'll just tell you, it doesn't form within a tendon. That would have to be a giant tendon. And it's just plain too big to be a sesamoid bone. So if it doesn't fit into any of those four other categories, we know that it's going to always fit in the ever-encompassing irregular category. So B, irregular, is the correct answer. Yay! Great job here. Sometimes the categories aren't very cut and dry, and that's okay, but the basic categories will help you understand what the potential function of the bone is, as well as what type of bone organization makes up the bone. So is it more spongy or more compact or a pretty even combination? All right, thank you for your time and attention here, and please always feel free to reach out with any questions.